now because it's too cold. Is everybody doing all right?
Yep.
Well, good. I'm looking forward to the start of our sixth year. We've got some plans in shape for next year, including this new website, which I'm hoping is going to help us operate more efficiently. And I can't thank Mike enough for taking on the burden of moving a lot of documents one by one, literally one by one, over to our new website. So, as Mike suggested, I'm here to talk about Family Tree Maker. I know a number of you already use this particular software. You're thinking about using it. How many of you already have it installed? Okay. And chances are you were around when, about a year and a half ago, Ancestry owned FamilyTreeMaker.com and announced to the world that they were no longer going to offer it. And it really freaked me out, and it freaked out a lot of our members. It freaked me out for any number of reasons. One is I love the software. Once I learn something, I really don't want to have to change to another system. I always believe that the only people who like change are wet babies. And even then, they scream. I've always liked Family Tree Maker because I think mainly it was the first program that I ever worked with. I don't consider myself a professional by any means. As a matter of fact, when I started, I only had 10 names on my side of the family tree. I had more from my husband's side, but he's English, and you know that's a walk in the park, isn't it? Compared to some problems that Jewish genealogists face, especially because my family is a Holocaust family, a lot of information was missing. But thanks to Family Tree and its little leaf system, I started to make some significant headway around 2009, and now I have more than 3,000 family members on my side of the family tree alone. And I do give Family Tree Maker a lot of credit. They've always been very, very supportive whenever I've contacted them with questions. So for me, it was very important when Family Tree Maker was separated from Ancestry and a new company, Math Kiev, took them over, that there would be as much of a seamless transition as there possibly could. By the way, I had to wonder about the company Math Kiev. You know, I'm always asking people about names, so I had to ask the company vice president, what is the significance of the name Math Kiev? Well, this is a company that started in the Ukraine providing support for Apples and Macs in the city of Kiev. And the company is owned by Jack Minsky, who's a Luntzman, so already familiar with a lot of the issues that have to that Jewish genealogists face. So the good news is that all of the things that we knew about Family Tree Maker haven't changed in its latest iteration. The best news is it's the same interface, the screen looks pretty much the same, but there have been four new features, one of which I think you're really going to like. It's a lot of fun to use. And the other three are also quite significant. One is that Family Tree Maker now integrates with Family Search, which is basically access to the Mormon Church library records. You are now able to sync up to the cloud and Ancestry, whether you're working on your phone version, on your laptop version, or your iPad. And also color coding, that's my favorite, and Photo Darkroom, which is a very easy to use program to fix your photographs within the program. So let's take a look at what the interface looks like today, and it's pretty much, if you're used to Family Tree Maker, isn't it what you've always looked at? It's pretty much the same. And again, these can be, your interface can be somewhat customized. I like to have the husband and wife and all of their kids here. I usually have them in order of birth. And you can also move the total index of all of your names over a little bit. There's some other fancy stuff over here. And then I keep some very basic information on the right-hand side. If I don't have a picture of the family member, I sometimes use a picture of a headstone, or I use a record if I remember to get around to it. And then I did something over here that is a little bit unusual. Let me blow this up so you can see it a little bit better. Can you see where it says birth, death, and then it looks like it says cast other? That's cause of death, other. And when a member of my family died in the Holocaust, I usually put in the description for their cause of death, Shoah, which of course is the Hebrew word for the Holocaust. It actually means, I think, firestorm or catastrophe of some kind. So this is not anything different than what you've been using with Family Tree Maker 14 or 14.1. Until you go to the upper right-hand corner and you see that there are some new buttons. Color coding is one. And also, let's see if I can blow this up. There is a green tree here, which is new. That means that stands for family search. This is the button that is going to help you access the records at the Mormon Church or LDS. And then over here also, this icon has changed a little bit, indicating how you're going to sync your records so that they're up in the cloud if that's something you choose to do. How are you doing so far? Is this making some sense?
Your earlier slide said there's a Mac and a Windows version.
Yes.
This is clearly the Windows version.
It's Windows.
Do you know if the Mac version is the same or?
I don't. You Mac people are a mystery to me. Does anybody know the answer to that question? Jane?
I don't know the answer.
Okay. All right. Sorry about that. But I can find the answer. If you send me the question, I can find out for you. Jane?
In order to link it, to sync things up with Family Search, do you have to have a subscription to Ancestry.com as well?
No. The question is, if you want to use Family Search, which is basically the Mormon records, you do need to have a free account with the Mormon Church, and that's just a matter of going to the Family History, is it FamilySearch.org, and coming up with a username and an ID. So you don't need to do anything more than that. Yes?
How do you sync photos?
I'm going to show you, because you can sync everything, you know, basically. Yes?
Is there a charge for using Family Tree Maker?
Well, Family Tree is, you have to buy the software, so yes. And if you want to get really deep into the Ancestry database, you need a subscription for that too. But the software itself is under $80, and sometimes you'll notice on our Facebook page, I let you know when it's on sale, so you can get it for less. You can ask for it for your Hanukkah or Christmas present if you don't have it yet. So Mike, the program that Mike is going to talk about is also a product you have to pay for. Jenny, to a certain extent, is free, but then if you want more information, you have to pay. Yes?
So if you have an old copy, you want to upgrade the prices less?
Yes, if you want to upgrade, although there was a time when it was a little bit less expensive, and I believe they're charging a little bit more now, but again, you don't want to get stuck with an old version of any software, really. You want to keep updating it, because at a certain point, it won't be supported, and it won't work very well for you. Yeah, Robert?
Could you at some point say what are the advantages of using a program like this as opposed to keeping your tree in order to have been Ancestry itself?
Okay. I think I'll try to answer that question, but I think I'll also defer to Mike and Jared, who probably are a little bit more literate on the subject. I'm a control freak, as all of you know. Okay, the emails, the obsession about the newsletter, all of that stuff, keeping control of the library. So I like to know that I have a copy of my stuff that I don't necessarily keep in the cloud and share with everybody. That's basically why I have a control of it on my laptop. Did you want to add to that, Mike?
Some of the other cases for staying on the desktop, this has a lot bigger library of reports and charts. It can do things like tell you if you've got bad data in your records. So the desktop software is more configurable, it's more flexible, and can do more things than Ancestry.com. So depending on how important some of these things are to you, you can have trees in both places, in one or the other.
Devin, you wanted to comment?
Yeah, so also a big thing is you don't have to have access to the internet to update your tree if you have the software on your computer. So if you're like scanning photos and attaching them, or you're doing something that you don't need to be connected to the internet, then you can't use, if you don't have access to the internet, you can't use Ancestry.
Or Family Search, for that matter. Okay, I hope that answered your question. I wanted to show you.
I have a
mechanical question, maybe you're going to get to it. Our whole, the index, the list of names.
Yeah, all my names.
Is that printable? I was looking for a way to.
I've been told it is, I haven't figured it out yet. I've been told it is, but it would require some time on my part. And I want to show you the part where I really, really want to print something out.
Because I saw print up on the corner.
Well, there are some things that are printable in charts, but sometimes you want to print a list. Yeah, I'll get to that.
Okay, thank you.
Again, we're just taking a look at some of the newer features. One of the things that will become apparent once you get 2017 installed is we're all used to, if we're using this, the little green leaves here, which tell us that there's a hint somewhere on Ancestry. But now with the 2017 version, we're getting these blue boxes. And that means that there's something on Family Search, something in the Mormon records. Maybe it's somebody's family tree, maybe it's a record that might be interesting. And that's brand new. And that is wonderful because, as we all know, the Family Search, again, the family histories, the Mormon church records, have a very robust database of Jewish records, particularly I found from Eastern Europe. So knowing that I didn't have to go outside of my program, that I could just click on some of these links and that would take me where I needed to go was extremely useful. As a matter of fact, let me just go ahead and go live for a moment to my family tree. And we're looking at Walter Hyman Rosen and his wife Leah Vivian Goldman. Doesn't get more Jewish than that, right? Rosen and Goldman. And here, you can see that Walter has both a blue box and a green leaf. So let's take a look and see what happens when I click on the green leaf. I actually don't even have to click on it. I just move my cursor over. And you'll notice that I'm being told that there are five records on Ancestry that might be of interest to me, two source records. That would be something like a vital record, and three possible tree matches. And if I click on that green leaf, then right within my window in Family Tree, I can see that in fact that looks like one family tree record, and that does look like a pretty good match because I know that this great uncle was born in Steele, North Dakota. I mean, who knew Jews were in Steele, North Dakota, right? But we're everywhere. And that he died in Garland, Arkansas. And when I click on Louder Family Tree, it'll show me that somebody has done a family tree with this Walter Rosen in it.
But you have to have an active subscription to Ancestry to be able to.
That's right. That's absolutely right. And that's going to cost you some money, too. Another way to do this, of course, is to go to the Family History Library, your personal library, your city library, and they have free access to a lot of Ancestry records. But then you have to do two things at once. You have to have your family tree maker open, and you're also at the library. Notice that if I were signed in, and even if I'm not, there's some basic data that is popping up here about the Walter Rosen in this family tree, and I can compare it and see, is this my Walter Rosen? And if I sign into Ancestry, I'll be able to see even more. But this is nothing new. This is something we were always able to do with our family tree maker, even in earlier iterations. Albert?
Now, without being signed in, you can hit that merge, and it'll still go into your tree.
Yes. So,
even if you're not signed in.
Yeah, so let's take a look, for example, at this actual record. Well, I'm going to go ahead and sign in. Of course, I have to remember my password, and I never can. This will be lucky if I can do this. Let's see. Yeah, I didn't think so. Okay. I can look it up, but as you were pointing out, Albert, even if I don't want to look at the actual source record, the Social Security record, if I think this is the right guy, I can hit the merge button, and all of this data will move over into my family tree. I always do it very, very carefully because I'd rather see the Social Security record itself and make sure it's the right guy. If I hit merge, now I can choose what information do I keep, what information do I discard, and maybe not include any of it because maybe it's just the wrong guy. But that's always been there. That's nothing new for family tree makers. What's new is that we can also go back to Walter and now click on the blue button.
Can I just ask a question?
Mm-hmm.
that green leaf going to, say you're not, you haven't paid for an Ancestry subscription, will that green leaf show up anyway? It
yes.
It just doesn't go anywhere when you pull.
Right, and unfortunately it doesn't go away either. That's kind of a pain in the butt, because I wish once I checked on those sources, then I'm not triggered to
right,
do it again
right,
and again
right.
and again. But
so
right now,
always there.
Yeah, it's always there. So you might wind up doing a lot of things over and over again. So now we have, again, the blue square. And when I click on the blue square, it's going to take me to Family Search. I've already logged into Family Search. And it's telling me that there is some kind of record on Walter H. Rosen, born, it looks like, in 1909, Ramsey, Minnesota, and died in 1992. So some of this is matching, some of it is not. It sure looks an awful lot like my great uncle, though, these references here to Kidder. So I can scroll down, and maybe Devin, you can tell us what this is really telling us from the Family History Library perspective. I just clicked on the record. Walter calling from the dead. Okay. All right, so.
So you want me to?
Yeah, go ahead and.
So what we're looking at is information that has already been inputted by someone else about this particular person. And so you can see the name has been given that's obviously not as complete as what Debbie has, a birth date, a death date. So this isn't necessarily a record. This is information that has been put onto Family Search by someone else. Now, if you wanted to see who is doing it, over there on the right, you can see latest changes. They'll give you the names of people. And if you wanted to, you could click on them and you could actually contact them, either by sending them an email or by sending them a message within Family Search. You want to see who else is working on this particular person. Now, if you scroll down a little more, Debbie, a little more. You said, yeah, so we'll have information about the family and see where it says sources. Someone has taken sources, so those would be records found on Family Search and attached them to this person on Family, attached them to this person. Similarly, how you would do to Ancestry. You would attach a record to a particular person in your Ancestry tree. That's the same thing with Family Search.
Okay. And one of the things I found in this 2017 version is we're not seeing exactly the same thing as if I were to go into Family Search itself. It's going to be sometimes slightly different, so I still wind up doing both, but what's really helpful is this kind of information. And I do know we've got the right Walter here just by looking at that family configuration, but I'm very reluctant about just wholesale cutting and pasting, merging this information here until I see documents. And I think most genealogists feel the same way. You just don't want to throw stuff into your tree because it just could be full of mistakes. But again, I'm just showing you what is different between the 2014 edition and the 2017 edition. And now that we've got these little blue boxes, again, a few more ways of finding information.
So it looked like the only source that person had listed was the Social Security. So all of those lived in at different years. There's no source information.
Not here, but now that I know that information came from Social Security, I could go to the Social Security Death Index. You know, there's other ways of confirming the information. It's a hint, you know, and that's the way you should take it. Until you actually see a primary source, then you probably shouldn't copy it verbatim. So again, that's something brand new, being able to search the family history or familysearch.org website automatically from Family Tree Maker. And again, here's another example. I did a search on my grandfather, Vilmos Monk, who was Hungarian, and when I clicked on the little blue box, again, I was given all of these sources. This tells me I'm on familysearch.org, Mormon records. Here are three different monks. None of them are mine, not a single one. But again, sometimes, you know how it is, it's all serendipity, isn't it? Sometimes you stumble on something great, sometimes not so much. Another new feature I already referred to, it's called Family Sync. And Mike and Al and a number of you have already talked about why you might want to sync up to the cloud, why you might not want to. If you travel a lot to do your family history, or you just want to take it with you, you're probably traveling with your iPhone, your smartphone, your iPad, and you want to be able to look something up that's in the cloud, the most recent edition that you put up there, will now be a little bit easier to do from whatever device that you're using. So you could have your information on three computers, maybe your daughter is helping you or your grandson is helping you, and you can all be syncing up to one ancestry tree. It's going to be a lot easier, and there'll even be there's not only the sync button in the upper right hand corner that you press, but if there are issues with syncing, maybe due to the internet or something else that's going on, you actually get little warning signs or kind of like weather reports that say this is not a good time to be syncing for whatever reason. You might get the orange sign that caution is in order, but the only time I've tried it, I've gotten the green button, and green means everything is going up to the tree that I'm allowing to go up to the tree. So that's another new function. But my absolute favorite is color coding. Did you have a question first, Neil?
I did, yes. So if you had a family tree maker, you're putting it on three separate computers, does that mean you need essentially three different copies, or can you just use one and load it on the other two?
Well, you're talking about downloading or having 2017, you're going to have to install it on one device, and then you will be able to download an app onto your iPhone or onto your iPad, for example. So you will have to get 2017 on all of your devices in order for this to work.
Okay, but I guess what I meant was you have to pay three times?
No,
or just
once. You get a license for all of your devices.
It's kind of unlimited.
Yes. Okay. Well, unlimited at least to that extent. I don't know how many more, for example, laptops you could have it on, I'm not sure how that works, but that's a good question to ask the company. Did you have a
thing?
Okay, all right. So let me show you how color coding works, because I think you're going to find this very, very useful if you are a visual learner and you like seeing charts and diagrams. It helps you keep your crazy family a little bit less crazy. If you were here when Israel Pickholz was here, you'll know that we're all related to one another. We're all intermarried with our cousins. And at a certain point, your family's tree is starting to look like a Mobius strip, isn't it? You know, you can't figure out how you're related to whom because you're related to everybody. So the new feature is going to be the color, using the color coding button. That's a new button as of 2017. And when you click on the color coding button, a little drop-down menu will appear asking if you want to color code a particular person, all the ancestors of that person, if you want to have a different color for your maternal side and your paternal side, or maybe instead of ancestors, you want to see all of your descendants. So let me show you how that might work by going live on that one as well. Let's see. Okay, let's say that I wanted to see all of the descendants in my family tree of Sam Rudolph, his sons and daughters, their sons and daughters, etc., etc. So I clicked on Sam right now. He's the person of interest. And I'm going to hit color coding. And I'm going to choose, let's see, I'd like to see all of Sam's, let's make it all of his descendants in green. Okay, so you can see there's a bar that has appeared. And anybody who is a descendant of Sam's will now appear in green. And if I look over here in my index of names, anybody who is a descendant of Sam's will also have a little green button next to them, so I can see it in the index as well, and that's kind of fun. If, for example, I wanted to, going up to color coding, I'm going to clear all the colors. Let me find one of my mom's family members. Start over here with my mom. There she is. And now I'm going to make her the person of interest, and I want to know who are all of her ancestors. So I'm going to pick a color, let's say red. And now anybody who contributed to my mother's arrival is going to have a red underline, and again, there'll be a red button also showing up in the index. So there you go. And the way that I've decided I'm going to use this at least once a year is I go to UNC for the Holocaust Remembrance Day, and I do the reading of the names, and I bring my own names, because I've got 160-some family members who perished in the Holocaust. So if I want to know which one of my family members perished in the Holocaust, remember, I've already coded that under cause of death, other. I'll give you an example by showing you my mother's father's place. Wherever I knew for a fact that somebody perished in the Shoah, I put Shoah under cause of death. Let me blow that up so you can see it a little better. So now what I'm going to do is come over here to the left side of the screen, to the index, and you see where it says filter way at the very bottom? Right over here? I'm going to hit filter, and I am going to filter in any fact having to do with the cause of death where the word Shoah has been written in under any data, I'm gonna get any description, you know, whatever matches that field. So this is how I am going to filter out all of the names, filter in all of the names of the people who died in the Shoah. I'm going to click on OK. Did I clear it? Did I? Okay, sorry. Cause of death, description. No, there it is. So over here on the right-hand side are all of my relatives who died in the Shoah. I'm going to hit apply. Notice now down over here on the left-hand side, the apply box is checked, and I'm going to save that list. I'm going to call it Shoah list. And I'm going to color it. I was telling the folks at Family Tree Maker it should be black because it's deaf, but they don't have that color yet. So I'm just going to choose yellow. And now anybody who died in my family is going to have a yellow button by their name. Now right now on the left-hand side, of course, it's all 166 names. If I take off the filter, the people who died in the Holocaust, only the people who died in the Holocaust will have a yellow dot. Now, to me, this is a phenomenal feature, obviously somewhat morbid in my case, but can you see how this would be helpful in some of the research you're doing if you want to see a pattern in your family? For example, last year, my niece called me up and she said, Debbie, are there a lot of women in the family who only have one child? And I said, you know, my grandmother, her mother, I hadn't thought about it before, and I decided to color code. And I could see coming down the paternal line on my dad's mother's side were all of these women who only had one child. Initially, I just thought, well, they died in the Holocaust. But that had been happening for a while, and that's a little bit unusual, isn't it? So we think there might be something genetic going on there. Can you see another way that you might use this color coding system?
You're trying to find out about the genetic defect or something.
Yeah. Who in the family had this illness? Or who in the family died of a heart attack? Or, on a less morbid note, who in the family served in the army or in the military in some way? And you could color code them. I really think it's wonderful that we can do this. Again, if you're visually oriented, this makes a difference. And you can put in more than one color. So you can actually see those weird cousins, you know, forming that Mobius strip and figure out from this color orientation how someone might be related to you. Barbara?
Debbie, is there any way to do a timeline?
There is, under publish, there have always been a lot of different types of charts that Family Tree Maker has done. I don't think there's anything new here. So I would encourage you to look under all of these different kinds of reports. We're looking at the charts right now. I'll just go through them real quickly, Barbara.
Right.
There are genealogy reports, which are the basically on a, I'll probably be doing this with Erwin a little bit later after the meeting. We're going to start with the names that he has, but if he has a tree, you'll notice like an important one. If it's in certain kinds of shared files, like GEDCOM files. And I've done that and haven't had any problem getting some trees from other people that way. Al?
Okay, so online you find a tree that matches yours, and you want to snapshot a portion of that merger, not individual by individual.
I believe there
isolate
is...
Isolate that, the individuals, and then merge them.
What I have done is I've completely imported it to a separate tree, and then when I've cleaned up what I think are mistakes or errors, then I'll merge it with my tree.
So how do you import a tree into a tree? How do you upload that? I haven't figured that out.
Okay, just again, you go to basically new tree, and you hit import an existing tree. Or you can download
one. From the Ancestry site.
Yeah, you would download it from the Ancestry site. There's a button here for doing that.
This is a blank slate. How do I know what's
going on? Oh, how do you know where the tree is?
Yeah.
Well, they're again, you can go to Family Tree Maker, searching for a name.
Oh, you have the name of the tree from the search. Each tree has a name.
Okay. Well, if it's open to the public, I believe that you can download it, again, by clicking on this button as a separate tree from yours, where it says download a tree from Ancestry. My experience has been a lot of those trees have been privatized, so you have to write to that person, and then they will either invite you to their tree, or they'll send it to you separately by email or some other shared method.
There are a lot of public trees.
But there are a lot of public ones, and those are the ones that I hold somewhat suspiciously, but I'll let Jared talk about that because he works in an entirely collaborative environment, and I know he's got a strong opinion about the value of that.
Well, that's what it's
about. All right. So
I don't think you can download a tree that you don't own.
If it's a public tree?
Even if it's public? I'll try and do it.
Okay. Are you going to use your laptop up here or do you want to use mine?
Either way.
Okay. Whatever you want to do. But we can find out the answer to those questions if you email me, or better yet, I think Google knows the answer to everything. Okay. Can you download someone else's family tree from Ancestry? Just use natural language. There you go. There's an answer for you. Of course, we don't know if it's the right answer, but it is an answer. Here's one, this one is from Ancestry itself.
Jamie actually said you can't buy a GEDCOM.
There's no way to paste someone's tree into yours. What you can do is to add a person to your tree, then go to the other tree for that person, and then click tools and add. So it basically sounds like it's one person at a time. Pretty slow. Okay, Mike.